upon the reading of your holy word. Father, we pray that you would anoint your words, and Lord, that you would anoint my tongue to bring these words forward. I pray that your Holy Spirit would just use me as an implement, and that you would open the hearts and the minds of all who hear this message, Father, that we would just meditate on these things, Lord, and allow your Holy Spirit to do his work in our lives. Father, I pray that we do all bow down to you in worship, in prayer, in all things that we do. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to go to Acts chapter 6. I'm going to read verses 3 through 5, and then I'm going to jump over to the book of Ephesians and read verse number 18 of chapter 5. So I'm going to go ahead and start reading right now. Acts chapter 6, verse 3 and 5. It says, "Wherefore, brethren, be out among you seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch." Now, jump with me real quick over to the book of Ephesians. And I'm going to read in chapter 5, I'm just going to read verse number 18. And it says the following: "And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit." Both of these passages have to do with being filled with the Spirit. Now, there is a difference between being filled with the Spirit and being indwelt with the Holy Spirit. At the time of conversion, we are indwelt by the Holy Spirit of God. Amen? We are sealed by the Holy Spirit of God. Being filled is something that should be on a daily basis. Being filled with His power, with His might, with His will. These is something we ought to be praying for. So I don't have to pray that the Lord indwell me with His Holy Spirit. He already did that. He's not taking His Holy Spirit out of me. I'm sealed. I belong to Him. I'm a child of the King. Praise God.
Amen.
But I do need to pray that the Lord would empty me and fill me with Him. So, as I had to ask myself, how do we be filled with the Holy Spirit? How? It's so easy to say, hey, you should be filled with the Holy Spirit. But how do we do that? Well, I'll put together three points that might help us in that. And point number one is understanding. Understanding. Understanding truth. We need to understand the truth in God's holy words. We need to have that. God has given us His Holy Spirit, and He dwells in us. This is a truth. We must understand the Spirit of God, His Holy Spirit. And in Sunday school, we've already shown the Holy Spirit has a personality. He directs us. He talks to us. He guides us. He is the third person of the Trinity. He is God, the Holy Spirit, who dwells in us. This is a truth we have to have an understanding of. Very important that we don't feel, not, you know, so many people, I don't feel the presence. I don't feel the Holy Spirit in my life. Doesn't mean he's not there, my friend. I just want you to know, because it's not about a feeling. It's about, I confess my sins and I repented of my sins and he forgave me of my sins. I was baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I know that I am indwelt by him. I don't need a special feeling for that. I believe it. And I know that it's a truth because his word says it's a truth. Jesus said that when he goes up home, he would send another comforter. And that he would come to us so that we're not left alone. Praise God. So I don't have to worry about a feeling. I know God said that I would be dwelt by his Holy Spirit. And God cannot lie. I love the fact that God can't lie. Mm-hmm. I can take his truth to be true. Oh, I can lie. Not supposed to, but I can. My mother can lie. Right? We can all lie. But God can't. Mm-hmm. Because it is against who he is. Mm-hmm. And God will not do what is against his nature to do. Praise God. So one of the things we have to have is understanding of the truth that, all right, he dwells in us. We understand God commands us to be filled with his Spirit. He's commanding us. He didn't say, hey, if you feel like being filled with the Holy Spirit, you know, do it. He said, don't be drunken with wine where it is excess, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be filled. You cannot do ministry effectively in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son, God the Father. You cannot do any of his ministries effectively if you are not filled with the Holy Spirit of God. You need his power to do it. This is good stuff, my friend. Good stuff. That means that if we are not being filled, because it's his will that we are filled with the Holy Spirit, if we're not being filled with the Holy Spirit, that means we're contrary to God's will. And it's not his fault, it's our own. Amen? We just need to empty ourselves. Be filled. That's awesome. The power of on high that is available to each and every single one of us is already dwelling within us. We don't see God moving mightily anymore, at least not here in America. Why? Because we lack. Oh, we don't lack in goods, material things. We don't lack in any of that. But what we do lack in is an understanding of what it means to truly give ourselves over to the Lord. I think we lack in that area in a big way. Luke chapter 11, and verse number 13. I'm going to read for you. If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? We need to be asking. God wants us to be controlled and guided by his Holy Spirit. If I fail to be guided by his Holy Spirit, it is my fault. I am the only one that will stop the Holy Spirit from working in my life. And that's a shame. Because I've been guilty of it. Just like everybody else. But the fact is that I can go to the Lord and say, Lord, fill me today with the power of your Holy Spirit. Fill me. I'm already in front. I need his power. Why? So I can go through every day in studying, prayer, and leading people to Christ. this is what I need to be doing. I need to be searching to do His will. So I have to have that understanding, one, that the Holy Spirit dwells within me, and two, I am being commanded to be filled with Him. If you're not being filled with the Holy Spirit of God, guess where your light is? It's starting to go under that bushel. You're not a light of the world. Oh, I can guide people to Christ. I can be somewhat a light. I guess as my father used to call me, be dim-witted. But we need to shine brightly. We need to be salt. These things we need to do. But we only can do it effectively for the Lord if we're filled with the power of His Holy Spirit. We have so much going on in our world today. Maybe this world hasn't seen the likes of it since back in the days of Noah. And the Lord said that He's going to come back again. It's going to be like it was back in the days of Noah. I know we have access through the internet to see what's going on in the world. I just know what's going on in our towns is unbelievable. The evil that is growing. And we need to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit if we're going to ever stand against it. This is how we're going to put that armor on. So we need to have understanding. We need to understand also that there is the presence of sin in our lives. So many of us think, we're perfect. No, we're not. You got saved. Praise God for your salvation. Amen. And that you're indwelt with the Holy Spirit of God. But that old sinful nature, still there, my friend. It lingers on. Yes, we hang it up in the closet. We put on the new man, the new life that was given to us. But that other life is always right around the corner, lurking. And we do sin. We have to have a truth. We have to come to that understanding that even though I'm a Christian, I'm a follower of Christ, I still have a sinful nature. Because so many people will deny that. And if you deny that you still sin, you're never going to confess that sin to Christ. Because, hey, I don't need to confess my sin to Christ because I don't sin. I'm perfect. No, you ain't. You're not going to be perfect while you're stepping on this earth. Our goal is to strive for that. Can we reach it? Probably not while we're on this earth. When we get into His kingdom, I'm not going to sin anymore. Praise God. But until then, that old nature is still in me. I still get mad. I still get messed up thoughts when people cut me off. It happens. I don't want it to happen, but I have to come to grips and have an understanding that, yes, it is still in here, and I need to get rid of it because sin blocks the filling of the Holy Spirit. Blocks. So as that power comes down, sin gets in the way. Boink. Kind of like a clogged sink. Clogged arteries. Good news. I don't need to drink Drano. Because it is the blood of Jesus Christ that will unblock my sin. Because I will confess my sin to Christ. And He unclogs it when it's applied with repentance and faith. Oh, if I tell the Lord, you know, forgive me of my sin, then I don't plan on stopping. There ain't no sense asking for forgiveness. I'm not really going to repent from it. I haven't changed my thoughts about that sin. I'm going to keep doing it. So is it even worth going, Lord, forgive me of such and such sin when I know deep down inside I'm still going to do it. Made no sense. But know this. That sin is blocking you from being filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Not indwelt, you're already indwelt. Being filled with His power is a totally different thing. Amen? So we want to be careful of these things. Why? I'm going to turn over to the book of the Song of Solomon. Yeah, I know it's one of those books that's hard to find, right? But it's right after the book of Ecclesiastes. In the Song of Solomon, chapter 2 and verse number 15, listen to what this says. It says, take up the foxes, the little foxes that spoil the vines, for our vines have tended grapes. When we do a study on this particular verse, what this is telling us is little sins can destroy our fruitfulness for God. Amen? God wants us to be fruitful. And those little foxes, those little sins, well, they're going to get in the way. They're going to hinder you from being fruitful for the things of God. Because, well, let's face it. If we're doing things in our own power, they're not going to be very effective for God. If we're carrying sin, and we don't confess that sin, man, that even affects your prayer life. It affects everything. Little leaven ruins the lump, the whole thing. Back in the Old Testament, they were told that if there was a leper in the camp, to put him outside of the camp, so he don't infect the whole camp. Sin is the same way. If you don't put it out, it affects everything. And it will affect it so that you don't become fruitful for the Lord. Now, I'm going to go back to the book of Luke, chapter 9, in verse number 23. And he said to them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Denial of self. We need to get rid of that self-centeredness. If self is the center, sin will always be a problem. You see. I don't want to get rid of the sin because it's mine. I like this, but it's always going to be a problem and a hindrance to ministry, to your fruitfulness for God. Now, I'm not saying that you can't do things for God, but the full effect of the power of the Holy Spirit of God is going to be lacking in your life. So we got to realize that we have it in us. We just need to confess it to the Lord and repent. We need to turn away from it. We need to get rid of it. We need to put it over there. We are called to renounce these things, to deny ourselves, and to seek His way of life. I'm going to go over to 2 Corinthians real quick, chapter 5, and verse number 15. It says the following. Listen. And that He died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto Him which died for them and rose again. So one of the steps is having that understanding. We need to stop living for ourselves and live for Him. You want the filling of the Holy Spirit? You need to live for Him. Amen? So that we can say, it's not me that lives, it's Christ that lives through me. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ that liveth through me. My sins have been put on the cross. Christ took my sins on the cross. He died for me. He bought me with the price. He paid my ransom so that I can go into His kingdom. And when I'm in his kingdom, I'm going to serve him. My mind is all up to myself and self now and serve now. Yeah? Amen. Man, I get a whole lot of silence here going on today. I know, because it's making you think. I know, because it made me think too. Spent a lot of time studying on the Holy Spirit this week because, well, let's face it, I was trapped in my house, trees on both sides, no electricity, no cell phone, no internet service, nothing. It was great. Me and the Lord. My dog. My dog just laid there staring at me like, what's the matter with you? No television, no nothing. Just me and the Lord and the Holy Spirit of God. And it was wonderful. But it made me stop thinking. The areas that I lack. That I need to empty. So that I can be filled. Amen? Praise God. So we need to renounce our way and seek His way. Who controls your life? That's what you got to ask. Is it you? Or is it God? Is it you? Or is it the Christ? Is it you or is it the Holy Spirit? Point number one to help us to know how to be filled with the Holy Spirit is to have understanding. Point number two is submission. We need to submit. What do I mean by submission? That's a good question, huh? Because a lot of people are confused about that whole submission. Renouncing my own way to seek above all else, the submitting to Christ as Lord, to be ruled by Him in every area of our lives. That is submission. Lord, I submit to you my finances. Lord, I submit to you my children. I submit to you my job. I submit to you my thoughts. I submit to you my eyes and my hands and my whole self. I submit all of it. Because you are the Lord of my life. If the Lord sits on the throne of your heart, or do you push him off to the side? Say, Lord, you can sit in my heart, but you ain't on the throne. It's mine. It's my spot. I'm an American. I have my rights. I have my freedoms. The Lord don't want to take away your freedoms. He wants you to have freedom to actually choose to do what is right. By seeking His kingdom first. Submitting to Him. How does this become a reality? Because it's hard. Is it not? It is. First, we go back to confession and repentance. That's where it starts. We've seen that we must understand the depth of our sin, but now we have to understand that we have to confess and repent. Many people don't change. Why? Because they're not truly confessing or repenting of their sin. But you know, in 1 John 1:9, he says that if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. Praise God! He will forgive us. If we truly confess and repent, I acknowledge my sin, I confess, God forgives. Man. And that's part of submission. I have to submit my sin over to Him. Lord, take it. It's yours. I don't want it. You died for this? It's yours. Amen? Repent. To renounce sin, to change the mind, to turn from the sin and turn to Christ and His will. Submission. I need to get rid of my own will and do His will. And not worry so much about everything because my will only going to get me in more troubles. His will won't. His will does not always line up with my will. No, it's my will that don't always want to line up to His will. That's the problem. I'm getting away. I tend to not want to submit. But these are things that we have to do. It's a conscious turning Revelation chapter 2. And I'm going to read verse number 5 for you here. Remember where, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will remove thy candlestick out of this place, except thou repent. We are to repent. Now, this was a letter to the church. The candlestick was the preacher. But it goes with the same with each and every one of us. We are to repent. You want it? Remember what he saved you from? Repent from that, man. You don't need to go back. You don't need to keep that sin. He saved you from that sin. He broke the chains of sin that hold you. You got to confess it. You got to repent from it. Amen. That's part of submission. That's part of submission. Yielding yourselves to God and His will. Confess. Repent. These are negative thoughts, aren't they? It's negative. Man, I gotta repent. I gotta go to God and confess that I'm a sinner and repent. That's horrible. I don't want to repent. I like me. So there's that negative aspect of it, but it's something that must be done. Now, here's the good news. Here's that yielding part of it is positive because it's placed itself totally and completely in God's hands. That's what that is. Romans chapter 6, and I would tell you straight up, study Romans chapter 6. It's great. And it's all about yielding. Romans 6:13. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Yield to Him. We belong. Don't yield yourself to the sinful thing. Now you belong to Jesus. Now I belong to Jesus. I know that I didn't sing that in the right tune. And I probably, if you're at home listening to this online and you have a dog, you probably started to howl. But I belong to Jesus. And so I need to yield myself to Him. He is the master. I do not have to yield to the old master. I need to yield to my new master, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. We have been set free. Verse number 18, Romans 6. It says, being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. He broke us away. So that we can serve Him in righteousness, in His righteousness. Why? Why do I want to serve Him? Because then people might be going to hell. Because the evil of this world is horrific and it's getting worse. Because the Bible says lawlessness is going to wax worse and worse and worse. It doesn't say it's going to get better. It's going to get worse. But while we're here, we're supposed to be using our time, especially as we see the day approaching, to bring people to Christ. Because someday, glorious day, the Lord's going to descend with a shout, and the church is going to go, and the Holy Spirit is going to go. Antichrist is going to take his position on this earth. And God's wrath is going to come upon this earth. What if one of your neighbors is one of those people that are left here? Because you didn't witness to them. I think about that. And it bothers me. That I don't always when I see my neighbors outside, go out there and speak about Christ. Some of them I will build a friendship with and then speak to them about Christ, but I can't dwell on building that friendship for too long on account of knowing that the day is coming. It could be tonight. I'm still going to be willing to do what I need to do. And so I need to yield myself over to Him. I need to place myself in His hands. I need to say, Lord, I am at your disposal. I will do what you want me to do. I will go where you want me to go. I want to be who you want me to be. I want to serve your will, not my own. I am yours. Do with me as you will. That is yielding. You know, when the angel went to Mary and said, you're going to have a kid. You're going to have a son. He's going to be Savior of the world. You're going to call him Emmanuel, God with us. And Mary said, what are you talking about? I ain't married. I ain't never going to have sex. The angel said, don't worry about it. The Holy Ghost is going to come upon you, and that thing that's going to be in your belly is going to be holy, the Son of God. What did Mary say? Your will be done. I surrender. She surrendered herself to God. She yielded to the calling. Man, some of them had a hard time yielding to come back Sunday night. Have a hard time yielding Sunday school. Yielding even our eyes to read in the scriptures. We wonder why the Holy Spirit doesn't work so strong in our country. Because many of us won't even yield to Him. But you look at what goes on in some of these other countries right now, Pakistan, India, man, people are coming to the Lord left and right. Huh. Why can't it happen here? Because we don't know how to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God anymore. We lack. And we don't need to. We need to just place ourselves and live in the truth of His words. We need to be a living example. We need to actually be like this. We need to not pretend that the old nature is gone. Realize it's still here, but we need to just surrender ourselves to the Lord. Amen? And that brings me to the third point. And the third point in being filled is walking in faith. Amen? We yield unto God and His will, filled with the Holy Spirit, His control, He dominates us. Now we act on the truth and assurance of God's word. Romans 6:11, likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. We need to reckon it, my friend. Gone. Yield to Christ. Follow Him as the Lord of our lives. The Holy Spirit will lead you. He will guide you. He will empower us. He will convict us when sin comes into our lives. He will tell us who to speak to. He will tell us how to study His Word. He will bring all things to remembrance. We need to get into His Word. We need to pray. We need to study. We need to say, Lord, here I am. I'm at your disposal. Whatever you will. However you want to use me, I'm here. Use me. We need to live and walk in the light of the truth of God's Word, not denying it. There are some people who only like some of the Word of God. Well, we're not here to like some of it. It's all of it. This is all the Word of God. The Holy Spirit moved upon people to write the Bible. And then when they were putting all these scriptures together to give us what we have in the Bible, that wasn't something that just happened overnight. People didn't just gather from all the different faiths and say, hey, let's use these books. It was years of praying and studying to get this canonized. Years. And it wasn't all just one denomination. There were many denominations involved in the canonization of this book. And they all prayed over the scriptures and they all came to agreement under the power of the Holy Spirit of God. They were filled with Him. Amen? So it wasn't just accidentally written. It actually was directed by the Holy Spirit of God. We need to learn how to resist our old selves and rely on the Holy Spirit of God to help us. Remember, filling is not a matter of feeling, but a matter of faith. Nothing is more hurtful than to be constantly inspecting our inner lives to see if God is fulfilling His promises. I don't need to examine myself to see if God is dwelling within me through His Holy Spirit. I already know it's there. I know God's working in my life. I don't have to worry about all that. That becomes because what happens when you do that, you start feeling that you fall short. Well, God really ain't doing nothing because look at where I am. Let the Holy Spirit of God do His work. Stop it. It doesn't mean we have to remember. It doesn't mean that we're perfect. And we're without sin. We're not pious. We're not holier than thou. Don't try and be holier than thou. Because you're not. Neither am I. You know how I know that? Because we're human beings. And our old nature is still in us. And we all fall. So don't try and ward yourself over everybody like you're better than them. Because you're not. We're not supposed to be like that. It's not about that, my friend. But we do have to remember that we can be and should be and should be willing to be controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. We read in Sunday school how He told Philip to go to a place and teach the Ethiopian the scriptures that he was reading. That man got saved and baptized. We read how Paul wanted to go to places that the Holy Spirit forbade him to go, but sent him somewhere else. Why? Because they were controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. When He said, I want you to do, they did. They didn't sit there and say, well, if I do this, what's in it for me? You know, I might have to give this up over here, Lord, if you want me to go over here. I mean, you want me to leave all this to go over here and have nothing, really? I don't think I want to surrender to that. I don't think I want that kind of controlling. I don't need you to lead me that way. I have a better idea. How about, Lord, if I tell you what I'm going to do, and you bend your will to that? Huh? That's not how it works, my friend. Surrender to Him. Let Him lead you and control you. You want to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God, you need to let Him fill you. That means if He leads, you follow. Might not be the most comfortable area, but you know what? There's a lot of times God will move us out of our comfort zone but His will. Sometimes we're in His will, and then we get so full of ourselves, so prideful about everything, God says, you know what? I think I'm going to have to knock you down a notch. Maybe two or three notches. So let's get right again. I want to use you. Are you willing to use? I want to fill you. Are you willing to be filled? Are you willing to empty yourself? Being filled with the Holy Spirit is not a once for all. It's an everyday process. Each day we seek understanding of God's words. We pray God to help us to see sin in our lives each day so that we can confess it and repent from it. Each day we do confess our sin and repent from it. And each day we need to submit our will to His will. The Lord Jesus did the same thing, didn't He? Father, if there's any other way, take this cup from me, but not my will be done, but your will. Mary said, hey, I'm yours, whatever your will is. The Apostle Paul always followed after God's will. Peter went after God's will once the Pentecost happened. These people were all willing to die for the Lord. Are we willing to get up and go to church? Are we willing to commit? Father, I pray, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit would indeed guide us and lead us and help us to repent of any sins that may be lingering in our lives. But Father, that we would submit our will to your will, that we would yield ourselves to you. I pray for the salvation of a lost and dying world. I pray they would understand Jesus died on the cross. He was buried and rose again. And you accepted that sacrifice. And so we are sanctified and justified through Him and your Holy Spirit that dwells within us. And so I pray that we would yield ourselves, Lord. Give us power and fill us with your Holy Spirit every day so that we can face the life in front of us according to your will. We thank you for that, Lord. And I'm here to say, if you want to accept Christ today, pray with me. Father, forgive me of a sin. I'm a sinner, Lord, and I don't deserve your grace. But you did send your Son to die for me. And you said that whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. For there is no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. So I confess my sin before you. I accept the work that was done on the cross. I accept the fact that our Lord was dead, but He rose again. And that I can be cleansed from my sin and forgiven of my sin. And I pray that you would indwell me with your Holy Spirit and help me to be the person that you would have me to be. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing a song. We're going to have fellowship. Amen. Let me get out.